Shalom Chavrim, I'm Stephen Ben Denon with Denon Institute of Biblical Research. I want to take and share with you some insights from the book of Hosea. And specifically, I need to speak to my Jewish brothers and sisters. I know my Gentile brothers and sisters, this will be a blessing to you. But there are some specific things that the Jewish people need to hear. There was the most profound revelation I've probably had to date about the identity of the Mashiach, was revealed to me in the book of Hosea, chapter 2. And I'm going to share that with you. And we will go through three chapters. I won't take you through everything that the Lord has shown me, but I will show you several things I'm sure will be a blessing to you as well. If we begin over in chapter 2, I'm just going to read every verse as we go through this so you can see the things that are laying in there hidden. Some things you may already know, some things that I already knew. But there were several key elements that the Lord revealed that I never knew. Okay, verse 1. Say ye unto your brethren, Ami, and to your sister, Rachamah. By the way, let me set the stage for you. Hosea, God has commanded him to take a woman of whoredom. And he marries a girl named Gomer. And he tells her to put away her ways. We find this out in chapter 1. And then as he lives with her as a wife, she begins to bear children to him. Now it's interesting, when we get into chapter 3, we see that he takes another wife. Now some people believe that it's the same wife, it's Gomer. Maybe she left him and he just comes back and takes her back again. But as I've studied the word here, it appears to be clearly that it is a second wife. let me explain to you what happens here, because God is using Hosea and what he's going to do with Hosea in his life to show Israel the way God sees Israel. So let's take and we pick it up here. This is where he says, let me back up to verse 10 in chapter 1. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea. And by the way, I believe that's also considered verse 1 in chapter 2 in the Jewish Bible. As the children of of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, ye are the sons of the living God. Then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together and appoint themselves one head. They shall come up out of the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel. Now, some people actually apply verse 10 here in chapter 1 as to the Gentiles. Now, there are scriptures very similar to that that do apply to the Gentiles. But he's actually speaking of the restoration of Israel. So it's not speaking of the Gentiles in this case, but the restoration of Israel. So he says, then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together and appoint themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel. Say ye unto your brethren, Ami, which means my people, and to your sisters, Rachamah, plead with your mother, plead, for she is not my wife, neither am I her husband. And let her therefore put away her whoredoms out of her sight and her adulteries from between her breasts, lest I strip her naked and set her as the day that she was born, and make her as a wilderness, and set her like a dry land, and slay her with thirst. Now, if you notice, God is taking Israel back. He's talking about the children. He's literally addressing this to the children or the descendants of the Jews that came out of out of Egypt and went through the wilderness journey. So he's addressing it to them. And he says, he's telling them, you know, for her to put away her whoredoms out of her sight and her adulteries from between her breasts. Because why? Israel had gone whoring after other gods. God knew it was going to happen. It was prophesied besides Hosea. But here's what gets interesting. He says, I will not have mercy upon her children, for they be the children of whoredoms. That's the future. When I say a future generation, that he was actually speaking, the ones that he would not have mercy upon would be the Jewish people, that when Yeshua came, that would be the ones that there would not be mercy upon, because they're the children of whoredom. You see, God's word requires not only mercy, but justice, purity, holiness. He requires these things of us. Now, watch what he says after this. I'll read it again, verse 4. And I will have mercy upon her children. Excuse me, I will not have mercy upon her children, for they be the children of whoredom. For their mother hath played the harlot. She hath conceived them, hath done shamefully. For she said, I will go after my lovers that give me my bread and my water, my wool and my flax, mine oil and my drink. And this is one of the reasons why it appears to be that Gomer may be the wife that he goes back to. Let's just follow it out though. Because no doubt Hosea, not only does he go and get this wife according to the commandment of God, has children by her, but even she is living a life showing what Israel is doing. Question is who is Israel's lovers? Therefore, very important verse now. Please, close attention to this one. You'll love it. Therefore, behold, I will hedge up thy way with thorns and make a wall that she shall not find her paths. The moment I read that verse today, I will hedge up thy way with thorns. Now God says he's going to do this. Do you remember who the way is? Yeshua said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And with him being the way, God said that he would hedge up their way with thorns. You remember the crown of thorns he wore? He was giving Israel an obvious sign. He was giving Israel an obvious sign of when these prophecies would be fulfilled. When the one that would come that is the way, and he even clearly tells them, I am the way. All they had to do is look back. And the word in Hebrew is derech. I am the way. And he doesn't just say with thorns. He literally says in thorns. Be uses the letter, the bet letter in there. Instead of saying with, you can translate it with. But literally, he would crown him with thorns. That way would be crowned. It would be on him. And here it is, the Messiah revealed right here before us. And make a wall that she shall not find her paths. Because God blinded her. He would hide that way until a later time. And she shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them. And she shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for then was it better with me than now. Isn't that interesting? For she did not know that I gave her corn, wine, and oil, and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal. You remember when Yeshua, he was feeding the multitude, the 5,000, the loaves, and there was another time when he fed the multitude again, so many thousands, and all the fragments that were taken up. And of course, the Pharisees were making the comment, you know, he says, our fathers ate manna in the wilderness. And Yeshua says, I am that bread that they ate. When he talks about that bread, when he talks about the silver and gold, it was Yeshua that came down in the Shekinah glory, the pillar of fire that spoke with Moses, because he claimed to be. When they said, you're a man out of 50 years old, and you say you've seen Abraham, he says, before Abraham was, I am. Ihaye. or Hayah. He didn't say Hayah, he said Hayah, Ani Hayah, I am. See, he claimed to be the very one that spoke to Moses in the burning bush. And that says the angel of the Lord. See, the angel of the Lord only represents God's presence, his form that he's taken upon himself, because it's the word messenger. It's not that God is an angel. He's not an angel. But you have to understand, people get it mixed up in Hebrew. The word melech, it can be used as either messenger or as like an angel from God. But it also can denote the form, because God clearly says through Moses, when he writes about the three strangers that come to Abraham and to Sarah in the heat of the day. And when they come down, what did he say? What did the Bible say? They called them melechim, angels, messengers. But Moses clearly identified the one that spoke to Abraham as Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, God Almighty himself. And Yeshua said he was the one that was there. And he claimed to be the one that was there with Moses. There weren't three with Moses, there was only one. And again, Moses declared that to be Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, God Almighty. So the thing is now we're finding out something very interesting. For she did not know that I gave her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal. Yeah. You know, it all started in the wilderness journey. God caused the Egyptians to give up all their silver and gold to the Jews as they went out. And the Israelites, in this case, not Jews, but Israelites. And as the Israelites were traveling and journeying on, they get out there and they build the golden calf, because they thought something happened to him. Moses died. Gosh, nonsense. Therefore, will I return and take away my corn and in the time thereof, and my wine in the season thereof, and will recover my wool and my flax given to cover her nakedness. And now will I discover her lewdness in the sight of her lovers, and none shall deliver her out of mine hand. And by the way, Rome, Israel has, since the time that the Romans came in, when Yeshua was there, because remember, it's talking about Yeshua's time right here, because clearly he says in verse 6, behold, I will hedge up thy way with thorns. I know it seems more like a metaphor, it's more like a metaphor, it's not a literal way. He's talking about Christ with the crown of thorns. So we know it's during Christ's time. And so we find out then that the lovers then was Rome, because they depended upon Rome. Just like Israel's doing today. They're depending upon Rome, what Rome will do for them. Didn't God say in another place, trust not in the shadow of Pharaoh? And all Rome is a shadow of Pharaoh. This is Hadad, Esau's descendant that was raised under Pharaoh's tutorage and then goes and becomes king of Syria, moves into Rome, and later his descendants become the pontiffs of today. Interesting. And I will discover her lewdness in the sight of her lovers, and none shall deliver her out of mine hand. I will also cause all her mirth to cease, her feast days, her new moons, her Sabbaths, and her solemn feast. Clearly, in 70 AD, before her lovers. You see, why do I call this her lovers at that time? Because you have to understand that people were given a choice. Barabbas or Jesus, which would you have released to you? They said, if you release Jesus, then you're no friend to Caesar. We'll take Barabbas instead, the murderer. Now the table has turned, and the children of Israel are ready to accept the Mashiach, the Messiah. They're willing because of the duress is bringing them back into the right place with God. And now the Gentiles, they've had a season with the Lord. Not every Gentile. Most Gentile Christians, there are not most, but many. There's a few Gentile Christians that are truly believers that love the Lord and are privileged and happy to be grafted into the vine with Israel. Even though we know, you know that your brethren, many of them, have no idea who you are. Just be patient with them. Give them time. So we find out that all these, the feasts are removed, the Sabbaths are removed, which are the Sabbaths plural, it's the holidays, it's the high holiday. Sabbaths is like Passover, and then at the one we're in now, this is another Sabbath unto the people, because it's the high holidays. Okay, and I will destroy her vines and her fig trees, whereof she hath said, these are my rewards that my lovers have given me. And I will make them a forest, and the beast of the field shall eat them. And I will visit upon her the days of Balaam, wherein she burned incense to them. And she decked herself with earrings and her jewels, and she went after her lovers and forget me, saith the Lord. You know what's really sad? Her lovers give her the fig trees. Reminds me of Pope Francis and Shimon Peres. Of course, it was an olive tree and not a fig tree. All this nonsense. It represents their food, though, their provision, the dainty things of life. And of course, even when you go outside of Joppa Gate, they have the new outside mall there, built beautifully, luxuriously and everything. But adorned in the very middle is a pagan temple to the Vatican, with the Virgin Mary, a statue of what they consider to be the Virgin Mary. Shame on them. Shame on Israel for allowing it. So anyway, he goes on to say, therefore, behold, verse 14, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. I will give her her vineyards and thence in the valley of Achor for a door of hope. And she shall sing there as in the days of her youth, and as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishi, and shall call me no more Bali. See, Bali in Hebrew means my husband. Ishi is literally, we translate that as my man, but the word Ish is what God called Adam in the beginning, which, as I've taught you before, is the fire of Almighty God. So now Israel is filled with the Holy Ghost at this point. At least it appears to be the way she does this. In that process, I should say. For I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. And in that day will I make a covenant for them with the breast of the field and with the fowls of heaven and with the creeping things in the ground. And I will break the bow and the sword and the battle of the earth, and I will make them lie down safely. And I will betroth thee unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness and in judgment and in loving kindness and in mercies. He brings the daughter of Israel, brings her back, restores her, and is engaged to her now. I will even betroth thee unto me in faithfulness, and thou shalt know the Lord. And it shall come to pass in that day, I will hear, saith the Lord, I will hear the heavens, and they shall hear the earth. And the earth shall hear the corn and the wine and the oil, and they shall hear Jezreel. And I will sow her unto me in the earth, and I will have mercy upon her that had not obtained mercy. And I will say to them which were not my people, thou art my people, and they shall say, thou art my God. I was going to go into chapter 3. But it's a little bit lengthy if I keep going, so I'll stop here. And I want to thank you guys for praying for me. I ask you to keep my wife in prayer as well. She has been tirelessly at my side during the time of being sick. When we, you know, we're en route to Israel, we stopped to see my wife's family. She's not seen in 25 years. And we decided to come in for a few days here. But as soon as I got in, I became very sick. And with kidney stones, not just one pass, ended up having two different bouts of them, was hospitalized, my wife there by my side. And then, of course, when I was at home, she was having to be up with me 24 hours straight. In other words, she's awake already, and then it hit me again, and she had to be with me all night long. So she's pretty exhausted from everything. And of course, now we're getting ready to head on into Israel here in a few days. So pray for me as well. And we thank God for you. And still going to be a little bit juggling getting the videos together again, because of one being the sickness. And then now it's always an internet change issue here as we're working our way back into Israel. But we're close to it, and we know that the hour is very serious there. And so we ask that you be in prayer for Israel as well. Thank you for being a part of this ministry. And we thank you. We do need your help more than ever. So if you want to be a part, if you're new to the ministry and you'd like to be a part of this ministry and to help us in taking the gospel to the Jewish people in whatever manner he sees fit. We don't just go out and throw ourselves on my people. We see how God sees fit to make that happen. So if you'd like to be a part of that, you can go to our website, IsraelReturns.com, and there's a little donation place there. Also, I think if you go to contact, our address is there. We do have family back in the States that picks up our mail and faithfully takes care of that for us. God bless you. We love you. And Shalom.